Really excited about this launch of our fall and academic year of lectures. But now we do have a book that Baylor is just publishing. Baylor University Press is a peer-reviewed press of sorts, and they are publishing the most recent Hurtado book, Destroyer of the Gods: Early Christian Distinctiveness in the Roman World. And we've got it at a special rate of just $20 a copy. Larry will be signing those. We'll be selling them tomorrow night after his lecture as well, after his public lecture. But you guys get an early dibs if you want one and a chance to have him sign them. So let me tell you first about Larry Hurtado. Larry, come on up here. Grab one of these center seats. And would you all join me in welcoming Larry? Larry is an Emeritus Professor of New Testament Language, Literature, and Theology from the University of Edinburgh. He's here with his wife, who is Shannon somewhere. There you are, who talked to that woman. She's got an area of study that is fascinating, and I'll guarantee you there's no one in this room who's studied it. It's absolutely fascinating. But anyway, we're not here about her per se. Larry has authored 11 books at this point that I can count anyway, well over 100 articles, including this brand new book, Destroyer of the Gods. He's got a special interest in the first two centuries of the Christian church. And it's an intellectual, spiritual, and emotional issue with him that I find fascinating and marvelous. And so we're excited to have him here. He'll be giving the lecture tomorrow night from our medieval pulpit back there. So you will be sharing a pulpit that has been held by many wonderful people, including one Supreme Court Justice, Antonin Scalia, lectured from there. So delighted to have Larry here. Carey Newman. Carey, come on up, sit next to him. Y'all give Carey Newman a round of applause. Carey Newman is the director of Baylor University Press. He is not holding that job simply because he's a marvelous person as a publisher and as an editor and things of that nature, though you were a senior editor, if I recall correctly, of academic books at Westminster John Knox Press in the past. But he's been a professor at Southern Baptist Theological Seminary or Southern Baptist Seminary, I think is what they call it, in New Testament. His PhD is from Baylor. He's got a Master's of Theology from the University of Aberdeen, and he's well-published, he's well-read, and he is the reason that Baylor is publishing Larry Hurtado's book right now. He's also the reason we got such a great price that we're able to turn around and give to you. So thank you, Larry, or Carey, for joining Larry. So we have Larry and Carey and Rubel. Rubel Shelly, come on up. Y'all join me in welcoming Rubel. I first met Rubel Shelly when I was a college student studying at Lipscomb University in Nashville. Rubel was one of the cutting edge preachers in a restoration church movement called the Churches of Christ, which were an effort in their genesis and still among many today to try and restore a New Testament church from the first century. And so Rubel has examined this issue from being a preacher. He also examines the issue as an academician. He teaches at Lipscomb. He's taught at Vanderbilt. He's taught at Rochester College. He's done adjunct teaching at Pepperdine and a number of other schools. Has a PhD in philosophy from Vanderbilt. Has authored over 30 books, including books in Korean, Japanese, Portuguese, French, and Russian. And so he's very prolific. He's very well thought through. He's also a very humble man. He worked for 3 weeks to try and keep me from putting him on this panel. He just wanted to come listen to the rest of these thoroughbreds run the race. And I said, no, Rubel, I need you on the panel. I'd like you on the panel. And he finally relented out of friendship. Thank you, Rubel. And last but certainly not least, the one area of books that I couldn't find, the one language that I couldn't find Rubel's in was German. So we got a German scholar. Come on, Christian. This is Christian Eberhart. Would you join me in welcoming Christian? Christian is a friend of the library, has studied extensively at the library. He's a professor at the University of Houston. He's a director of the religious studies there, a chairman of the Department of Comparative Cultural Studies. He holds his BA from the University of Heidelberg. He has a master's in theology from Harvard, a doctorate in theology from the University of Heidelberg, a second doctorate in New Testament from the University of Mainz. He's written 5 books. He's written many articles. He's a friend of the library, has attended many of these lectures, and we finally talked him into getting on one of the panels. Thank you, Christian, for joining us today.
Thank you.
That's our panel. So, with no more delay, let's get into this discussion. The New Testament church started on the day of Pentecost. We don't know the exact date, but let's just say early 30s AD. The date of Pentecost is the date when Peter stood up. As related in Acts chapters 1 and 2, Peter stands up and he delivers the first sermon of the church. Thousands were baptized into the church that day as they came under the conviction. These were people, Acts tell us, from a number of different areas, north, south, and east, and west of Jerusalem. They were all gathered into Jerusalem at that time, and they took their newfound faith and went off to the various lands from whence they came, taking Jesus and the New Testament church with them. It's a profound moment in the book of Acts when the church opens its doors beyond those who are Jewish. We read about the conversion of Cornelius, and then we read about the subsequent issues that arose within the church in Acts 15 when the church does this big debate. The debating point is, do the Gentiles who want to become members of the church have to first become Jews? The decision is made after debating, discussing the scriptures, arguing, going back and forth, seeking counsel between the elders, the apostles that were there. The decision is made that you do not need to become a Jew in order to become a Christian. Paul goes out to the mission fields and again, and the rest is, as we say, history. So the church starts out Jewish, and yet it doesn't maintain that Jewish status for long. So I want to start with you, Christian, your end of the table. I'd like you to discuss for us, please, the separation of the church from Judaism.
Okay. I was told to keep reading if it's too loud, and if it's not loud enough, I as well. Thanks for the question. This is a very interesting question, which has been debated differently in the past, not only years, but decades. More recently, there were a number of scholars saying that, for instance, for the first century, and that would include the dates 30, 32, 35, whenever we would date those events of Pentecost, that during those years, for the entire first century, we should indeed not talk about Christianity yet. Christianity is really more a second century phenomenon. Christianity only separated itself out from Judaism much later, and particularly post-destruction of the Second Temple, so that means in the year of 70 and then whatever comes after. So this is the scholarly opinion. The question is, of course, just because scholars think that, is it appropriate? My own take on it is that I would be a lot more careful. I would say that there were certain distinguishing elements in which really this Jesus following group, and that's maybe a safe way of calling them, in fact was quite distinct from Judaism. And you already pointed to one aspect. Do you have to become fully Jewish? Now, that, of course, for a good Jew meant, would you have to observe the entire Torah with all the 613 laws and regulations that pertain thereto? And that's, of course, only for men. So women have fewer, but Jewish men would have to observe these 613 laws. Would you have to do all of that? In that regard, obviously, the early church said right away, well, we'll reduce it to whatever, 3 or 5, and that was a bit debated too. But so there was already a certain difference. And so I think that that is already one indicator. I'm not going to list all of them, but that's one indicator where the early church said already, we want to be different. Now, I don't want to speak too long right away, but I just want to at least add the one note that, of course, Torah observance was a thing that not only Christians, this full Torah observance was not only a thing that the then Christian community started to question, that was also questioned elsewhere. For instance, Qumran folks, these people living in this compound on the Dead Sea, they were also actually quite skeptical whether humans could really fully obey all the lower commandments, and decided no, and therefore we need a council of the community. So, you know, that was a distinguishing factor for the Jesus followers, but then again, they weren't the onlys to have those concerns.
Okay, so Larry, let's bounce over to you with this and talk to us about it. Christian has set up the issue. There are academicians who view it differently. Some are saying that Christianity as a non-Jewish concept really doesn't evolve until certainly after the destruction of the temple. But maybe even after the second revolt against Rome in the early second century. Explain where your perspective is on that and how you came to your perspective.
I would say that we have to distinguish at least two things, or two questions. One is, when and was what we call, or what became early Christianity, was it, and how was it distinctive? How was it distinguishable and distinctive amongst the variety of forms of Judaism of the time? And as Chris has said, I think that that distinctive feature that distinguished the Jesus movement, let's call it that for the moment, from other forms of Judaism, that distinctive feature was there from the beginning. The central distinguishing feature, of course, being the way in which Jesus is central to their understanding of God's program and of God's purposes and of how to relate to God. That centrality of Jesus immediately set apart these circles of Jewish followers of Jesus as a distinctive kind of Judaism, or a distinctive kind of religious movement within Judaism. So distinctive, but not yet separated fully distinguished from Judaism as a whole. That latter process of separating, of becoming a distinguishable religious tradition in its own right, as Chris has said again, most of us would probably put later. It's a process, though. It isn't as though people got together and in 105 AD a group of bishops decided, let's start our own thing, right, we'll go and get it copyrighted. It's a process, by the early second century, you have the Christian father Ignatius of Antioch. And he's already referring to Christianity and to Judaism as if they are somewhat distinguishable things. And that seems to me, as I recall, to be the earliest instance of the use of those terms in that way. But we shouldn't imagine that because Ignatius thinks of Judaism and Christianity as distinguishable things, that everybody did. That's the other factor, is that this process of separation or of becoming a distinguishable entity probably went on at a different pace in different locations. But fairly clearly by the third century, by about 200 or so and thereafter, nobody's in doubt that you have this quite distinguishable religion, as we would call it, and it's known characteristically as Christianity, and its adherents characteristically as Christians.
Okay, I want to probe this a little deeper with y'all, and then Rubel and Carey, I'm coming to you next, so get ready. But I want to probe it a little bit deeper. There is a school of thought that argues that When the Jewish revolt happened 68, 70 AD, when that Jewish revolt happened against Rome, the Christians were by and large, the Christian Jews of the region, the Messianic Jews, were by and large pacifists. And they did not join up in arms with the Jews. And as a result, in fact, a lot of them probably left Jerusalem, maybe seeing this as a fulfillment of what Jesus had said that's written up in Matthew 23, 24, that range. But there is a school of thought that says that the Jews got upset with the fact that the Christians would not stay and fight. And so what had been a sect within Judaism up to that point, the Jews themselves pulled away from as they rewrote their prayers and said to be a follower of Jesus is not to be a Jew. So here's the question. Were the Christian Jews separating out into their own group, or were the Jewish non-Christians expelling the Christian Jews and saying, you are not of us? Any thoughts?
I would say more likely the decisive action was the latter. To go by the Apostle Paul, let's take him for example, who was earlier operative in the 50s. I'm one of those who believes that Paul steadfastly always saw himself as a Jew. There was an interesting book published a few years back entitled Paul Was Not a Christian. And I agree, he was not a Christian. In the sense of the term come to use later, that is to say, a Christian is someone who is not a Jew. I mean, that's typically, by the way, the way in which today Jews would regard the question, and therefore your notion of Christian Jews, they would say, I'm sorry, that's a contradiction in terms. You can't be that. To be a Christian is not to be a Jew. If that's what you mean by the term, then yes, Paul was never a Christian. He was steadfastly, to the end of his days, a Jew following the God of Israel, but believing that the God of Israel had made a special revelation to him and required him now to enfranchise Gentiles, pagans, into the God of Israel and to spread the salvation that came through Jesus universally. He himself, however, says, in spite of his steadfast effort to remain a Jew, and as testimony to that in 2 Corinthians 11, that on at least five different occasions he underwent a flogging in a Jewish synagogue, probably in the course of his travels throughout the various cities of the diaspora of Greece and modern-day Turkey and so on, that on at least five different occasions he submitted to, and you could only be flogged if you were a Jew and if you willingly submitted to a flogging. If you did not wish to be flogged, you basically said, I renounce you, I refuse to accept this, in which case you're no longer regarded as a member of the Jewish community. And on at least five occasions, Paul says that he underwent a synagogue flogging voluntarily. That's how much it meant to him to keep his membership card active as a loyal Jew. So the action is coming, the hostile action is coming from the synagogue that is finding Paul's version of Judaism unacceptable or problematic in some kind of way. The second text, early text that I would refer to, are the passages in the Gospel of John, one in chapter 12, as I recall, which refers to you will be put out of the synagogue. You will, and that means effectively being expelled from the Jewish community. And as far as the Gospel of John is concerned, again, this separation is a disciplinary action from the standpoint of those executing it, a disciplinary action expelling Jewish believers in Jesus who are seen for some sort of reason to be beyond the pale, unacceptable.
All right, you finished before I pulled it up. If I'm not mistaken, when Paul's on trial, the Jewish accusers of Paul call him of the sect of the Nazarenes. And that Greek word for sect is the same word that would have been used for Pharisees or the Essenes or any other sect. Now, in this regard, Rubel, I'm coming to you next. It seems to me, and you've spent a lot of time reading Socrates and these other Greek writers in your studies, it seems to me that Judaism itself, for several hundred years, had been battling against becoming Hellenistic as opposed to being Judaistic. Of course, we know about the Maccabean Revolt and all that was behind all of that, but You've got Philo in Alexandria writing. You've got the Torah and the other Jewish writings being translated into Greek in Alexandria, most likely. You've got this massive movement of Judaism to become, in maybe even biblical interpretation matters, Greek, Hellenistic. So how do you mold that into this discussion? Weave that in and talk to us about it.
Well, you do and you don't. To pick up the point that Larry was making, I agree. Paul, and I suspect most of those early Jewish Christians, certainly didn't see what they were doing as a repudiation of their Judaism and their Jewish past, not their Jewish scripture. They saw themselves as the flowering and the blossoming of all the promises that were back there. And as late as what? Paul is standing good for others' vows, paying the fees in Acts. He synagogue all through Acts. First thing he wants to know when he goes to town, is there a synagogue? And he will go, and he will respectfully participate, speak when opportunity was given to speak. If there's not a synagogue, is there a proseke? Is there a house of prayer, a place of prayer out by the river? So all of these things, I really want Larry to talk a bit later about the bookishness of the Christian religion as part of its distinctiveness as it relates to this, and how we talk about Old and New Testaments and whether these are separate documents. But to your specific point, if you go back into this intertestamental period that most of us Protestants don't know very much about, because when we leave off reading the Old Testament, Persia is the imperial power of the world. When we open and begin reading our New Testaments, all of a sudden, we're not talking about Persia, there are Romans, and oh yes, in the interim, this minor character, Alexander, that some call the Great, has come along, and there's been the division, and the Ptolemies and the Seleucids, and translation. During that period of time, there's a great pressure on the Jews to Hellenize or to embrace or adapt their religion. And especially in the books of the Maccabees, First Maccabees, you have in the intertestamental literature an account of how these pressures were being placed and how some were accommodating, others were resisting, and of course you get the Maccabean revolt and Hanukkah, not as an alternative to Christmas, but as a Jewish festival predating Christmas. And you have during this period of time faithful Judaism trying very, very hard to maintain integrity, some feeling compelled to go out into the desert and form insular communities, others within the larger social context just trying to preserve their integrity as people of the Abrahamic covenant. And Christianity, as it emerges, is not a Hellenistic phenomenon. It's not impinging on Judaism. It's born from the womb of Judaism. And for the first, shall we say, 6, 8, 10 years down to at least Cornelius, it's a Jewish sect. It's a Jewish subset. It's a Jewish group saying, we believe we know who the anticipated Messiah Christ is. We know his name and address even, Jesus Nazareth. And as Christianity then begins to move, or as this Jesus movement within Judaism begins to move, it is not moving out as an alternative to Judaism. It's going within the framework of Judaism. Paul's going to the synagogue. He's still observant. He's accepting the lashes in the synagogue. And I appreciate the fact in Larry's book that as he talks about the uniqueness of Christianity emerging from that, not only the bookishness that I hope he'll talk about a bit, but a point that I will have, especially undergraduates reading this book, to try to grasp. Judaism was allowed within the general empire a rather unique status as a monotheistic religion, not required to do certain obeisance and deference to the Roman gods, especially to the Caesars, as they begin to declare themselves worthy of worship. But that's okay, because they're an ethnic group. And as an ethnos, a group to themselves, their religion within their ethnicity allows them to do some unique things. And the Romans were pretty good in some contexts about allowing them to maintain your uniqueness. The Christians began to get in trouble when that breaks down in terms of the separation of Judaism and Christianity. The Christians are no longer welcome in the synagogue. Others are recognizing Christians and Jews as being hostile to each other. Christians no longer fly under the cover or the flag of Judaism for their uniqueness in terms of the worship of the one God revealed through Christ and given exemption from some of the imperial edicts about deference to the Roman gods. So I don't think anything out of the Socrates experience or the Plato literature is particularly insightful to it, except for the parallel some of the apologists saw between Socrates and Jesus.
All right.
These are martyrs who die for their faith, and some of them want to argue they're both prophets to their people in a unique way.
All right, we're going to return to that point because I think that's an important point, and I want to bring that into the bookishness idea as well in a moment. But before we do, Carey, one of the things that strikes me that I'd like you to speak about is exactly what Rubel's saying. The Jews are an accepted religion. They're deemed to be an old religion, which is one of the requirements of being accepted. No new upstart religions. You know, if the gods are the gods today, then surely they've been around for ancient times. An issue Paul had with you know, when he was addressing the Athenians, a bunch of pagans, and he tries to make it clear, this is the God that you've already been worshiping as an unknown God. This is not just something new. So while Christianity can fly under the umbrella of Judaism, and Paul can even see the faith as successful in Corinth because of that, somewhere in here, Christians get a bad name. They're bad neighbors. They're scary people. They're no longer the Jews, but some perception in the Roman world in the first 100 years of the church changes, where all of a sudden the Christians are viewed as bad neighbors. Would you talk about that for a minute?
Yeah, our discussion thus far has made it seem that Christians were just a kind of woolly brand of Judaism. But inherent to Christianity from the start was a difference that was going to separate themselves from Judaism. Christians could not maintain their Jewish identity forever as a sect of Judaism. And why so? Well, Christians gathered on the first day of the week, and they gave homage publicly and repeatedly to Jesus as God. Now, they can't remain Jews and do that. I'm gonna plug an earlier book of Larry's. In fact, he has spent the bulk of his career demonstrating one thing and one thing only, namely that the public repeated observance of Jesus as God through preaching and baptism and the reading of scriptures, taking the Old Testament and putting substituting Jesus for God in the reading of scriptures, designates Jesus, even though within the matrix of Judaism, this public worship of Jesus is the thermometer, if you will, for measuring divinity. It's not what's said about somebody, it's what's done with respect to a figure. And Larry has focused on the public worship of Jesus as the litmus test for belonging to Christian groups. And this was going to separate Christianity from Judaism. And it didn't take all the way to the end of the first century. It was present in the first 36 months of the church. This difference, this worship of Jesus, is the thing that's going to cause Christianity to be abhorrent to Jews. So this whole notion that somehow the further that Christianity gets from Jerusalem as it travels in the Greco-Roman world, and the longer it takes from Resurrection Sunday for Christians to form this time and geography notion is all wrong. Most scholars will say the further you get from Jerusalem and the longer from the resurrection, the more pagan Christianity becomes. Well, by pagan, what they mean is that in Judaism, Jewish Christianity, Jesus is just the Messiah. Within Greco-Roman Christianity, Jesus is God. And how do you get from Jesus being a Messiah to Jesus is God? Well, here it is. Christians paganized. They borrowed from their neighbors. Actually, from the start, Christians were giving homage to Jesus as God. And this is the difference. And it happened in Jerusalem. And it happened in Palestine right after the death and resurrection. So, you know, yes, it's Jewish matrix. Yes, it's within the framework of Judaism. Yes, Paul understood himself to be fulfilling the Jewish scriptural covenant and the Jewish narrative. But no, I mean, the dynamite was lit on Resurrection Sunday.
It's a terrific argument, I would say, put this way. It's a terrific argument over the family silver.
Yeah.
Paul
wait,
is...
Wait, that was good. I want to make sure we got that. A terrific argument over the family silver.
Yeah.
Okay, all right, continue. Explain that one, please.
The family silver is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and that whole biblical tradition. And the question is, who speaks for that? Who are the rightful heirs of that? And the kind of language that Paul is referring to, for example, he describes himself in the epistle to the Galatians prior to his own revelatory experience, prior to the so-called Damascus Road experience, he describes himself as seeking to destroy the ecclesia. And that's the term that he uses in the epistle to the Ephesians. The Jesus movement he refers to as the ecclesia. He probably does so because that's what they refer to themselves as. And the term ecclesia is a Greek word which we translate, unfortunately, as church. The term ecclesia is a Greek translation, which in the Jewish language, in Jewish parlance of the time, such as the Greek Old Testament, is the term that is characteristically used to translate Hebrew words which refer to the congregation of Israel. The Kahal Yahweh, or the Edad Yahweh, the congregation of, it's often translated in the Old King James Bible, the congregation of the Lord. And that's the Hebrew terminology being used. And it would be in Greek, ekklesia tou Theou, the ekklesia of God. It looks as though, already at that point, these Jewish believers in Jesus are claiming to be the ekklesia, the people of God. That their understanding of what God has done in Jesus is the right path. And they're basically saying, the tradition belongs to us. But notice what they're doing. They're not saying, we don't like the old tradition, so we're going to start a new thing. They're not being entrepreneurial sort of thing. Let's go out and create a new product. They're saying, we are the rightful heirs of Abraham, Isaac, David, Jacob, and so on and so on. So to us belongs the family silver.
Right.
And other Jews who are not convinced, to put it mildly, of Jesus' messiahship and of his lordship are basically saying, no, you're the maverick. To us belong. So that's what I mean by an argument over the family silver. But already at this point, and Paul's so-called persecution, as any parent will know, your children think you persecute them, but you know you're disciplining them. Paul, when he was doing it, did not think of himself as persecuting anybody. He thought of himself as disciplining dissident Jews whose devotion to Jesus, in my judgment, the main cause being, he believed that their devotion to Jesus, their reverence for Jesus, was endangering the religious integrity of the Jewish people. But already at that point, it sounds as though these people are referring to themselves as the ecclesia, as God's people. The other point I want to make is certainly if you track forward to the 60s, early 60s, we have the report of Tacitus and of Suetonius of Nero's persecution, Nero's pogrom conducted against people whom Tacitus refers to as Christianoi. So he uses the term Christian. Now some people would say, well, yeah, he uses the term because he's writing in the second century, so he's referring back to them as Christians. But I think that a fair case can be made that already at that point, people were referring to them as Christians. That's on that term, that's the other point to make, is that as often happens with other groups, the term Christian does not seem to have been invented or adopted by believers, but seems to have originated as a term of abuse or description by outsiders. The analogy is, for example, the Unification Church. People of the Unification Church were referred to as Moonies. And the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints came to be referred to by outsiders originally as Mormons. Now, after a period of time, even Mormons will accept the term Mormon, but it originated as a term of abuse from the outside. And the term Christian originated as a term of abuse from the outside, and then comes to be, and by the time of 1 Peter at least, he's willing to wear it. But it's very interesting to note also what that term is. Christianoi means the Christ party, the people who reverence this Christos figure. And so again, it's further indication that what distinguishes them, what identifies them, is the prominence of the figure of Jesus in their religious life and in their religious beliefs.
All right, in that regard, let me see if I can put this into a context, and then we'll take it back to you, Chris, to jump in at this point. As I hear you talk, Larry, it occurs to me that you've given us much of what Paul said in Romans about the Gentiles being grafted in. Now, Mark Black, where are you? Mark is here somewhere, back there. Mark's teaching Romans, so I don't know where you land on all of this stuff. He teaches at Lipscomb University, the Fighting Bisons of Lipscomb U. And I don't know where you land on this, but my belief about Romans is that Paul is writing to a church that has experienced, in a sense, some of the division that's later going to be found more prominently. And I would suggest that we've got some good indications, both from the New Testament as well as from historical Roman writings, that at one point the Caesar kicked the Jews out of Rome. Now, if we've got a church that's formed by Roman Jews, and there were Roman Jews present on the day of Pentecost that came into the church and went back to Rome, certainly Gentiles have joined into that church, but it's a Roman Jewish church. And so it's Jews who started it. It's Jews probably who are teaching it. They're in charge of the treasury. They're in charge of the dispersals to the widows. They're in charge of Sunday school or life groups or whatever they're calling it in their day. They keep the attendance. They've got the houses. It's a Jewish church, and all of a sudden the Jews are kicked out, including the Christian Jews. And now the Gentiles are left running the church. Jews are gone for a couple of years. Aquila and Priscilla are gone, and others. And 2 years later, let's say, we don't know when, but the Jews come back. And the Jews, I can see human nature. The Jews coming in saying, hey, you guys did a great job while we were gone. Now move out of my office and I'll take back over. And Johnny's got the treasury and Avram's got, you know, whatever he's covering. And the Gentiles are saying, you know, we handled this pretty good without you. We've been going pretty good. So into that milieu, Paul writes Romans. And he tries to explain to the Roman church how Jew and Gentile are distinct, and yet in Jesus are one. Ephesians would later call that mystery of how God has broke down the wall of separation between the two. But into that milieu, Paul writes and he says that, look, the Jewish tree is the tree. The Gentiles have been grafted onto that tree. But the faithful among the Israelites are they have the family silver, to use your analogy. Now, I don't know where y'all land on that as an approach, but it seems to me in a microcosm of Romans, we're already seeing a division between a Gentile element of the church and a Jewish element of the church, perhaps brought on by the expulsion of the Jews for a period of time from Rome. Christian?
I would like to look back a little bit on our discussion so far and then just bring up an example of why this whole issue of calling something Jewish or not Jewish is really complex and at least difficult. And that's why I think many scholars can write a lot about it, and that they can write a lot about is simply the reason, because you can heartily disagree and can continue to disagree. Much of what we've been talking about, like singling out somebody as the key person, Jesus as the Messiah or as God, in fact has been done previously, that Jews follow a particular person as Messiah is something that's happened all the time. It's happened before Jesus, it's happened after Jesus. The question was maybe more whether these particular Messiah figures were on a military mission. Were they on a mission to, with violence and military force, to overthrow some kind of government? Jesus didn't really do that. It would be interesting actually to study other Messiah figures, where they're all doing that. But the example I wanted to refer to is Jewish communities in the diaspora, and since we talked about Philo and Alexandria, let's just take Jewish folks in the diaspora in Egypt. They actually did some un-Jewish things, and yet probably nobody here would ever think that we would call these Jews not Jews. What are the un-Jewish things I'm referring to now? Christians might have called Jesus God and might have celebrated on a different day. But the Jews in the diaspora of Egypt, they suddenly built a different temple. Now, if you know how important it was for Second Temple Judaism, which is called by us today Second Temple Judaism, precisely because there was only one temple, and that was the Second Temple, enlarged at some point by Herod, but there was only to be one temple, and if you read all the scriptures, there is only really one temple. Now, they built a temple in Egypt and brought the sacrifices there, ritual sacrifices. They had their own high priest. A high priest who's, and I hope I get the numbers right, I think it was Onias the Fourth, whose father, Onias the Third, and maybe it was Onias the Third and the Second, but his father got killed in Judah. So, which means, you know, we have a different group here, and now all the elements that we're trying to muster as kind of evidence for Christians to be different kind of apply there to a certain degree, right? We said, okay, Paul, you know, he was persecuted, he was flogged 5 times, almost left for dead. You know, that certainly makes sure that, or demonstrates that there was quite a bit of animosity between, okay, now whatever we call it, Jews and Christians, you know, or Jews and the Jesus followers. So we take the degree of disagreement being manifest in physical abuse as that kind of sign. And then, you know, we could continue endlessly with dogmatic issues. Okay, which day do we actually worship Jesus, you know, or God? Is that on a Sabbath, or is it on Sunday, the day of the resurrection? But all of these elements, again, would mutatis mutandis to some degree apply to those Jews in Alexandria. And then again, that's just only one example out of many. So what we're really having, and the problem for us trying to define that sort of neatly, as scholars like to do, is really the incredible flexibility and multifacetedness of Judaism, which, you know, can't really be defined by one category. Or, and what would that be? Is it a book, the Torah? Or is it the temple? I think most Jews in Second Temple Judaism would probably say it's rather the temple, but maybe not. Is it the Messiah? Or what else is it? Is it, you know, particular type or style of worship? It's very difficult to really define that, and that's why the discussion is difficult and complex, and, you know, we scholars can write lots of articles about them, and that's how we earn our living. So I hope that helps a little bit as we go forward there. I'm pretty sure that Christians didn't envision leaving the house of Judaism. On the other hand, you're perfectly right, more often than not, then it becomes how they are pushed out, and that's when all the exonyms come in, right? I mean, exonyms is a name that's given to you by others. By the way, when we refer to Native Americans, most of these names are exonyms. The Apaches do not call themselves Apaches. The Sioux do not call themselves Sioux. Those are all names from the others, and just here the same. The question is, how do they call themselves from the inside out? Those are usually different names. And by the way, for Christians, it was usually the way. We talked about Acts. In Acts, the Christians are the way, which means you walk, you follow, well, Jesus, of course.
Well, one of the Jewish terms, early Jewish terms, is they're referred to as Nazarenes as well.
Yes.
In the spirit of the scholarly dialogue, can I say that, yes, we do disagree on some things. It seems to me that the temple at Leontopolis is a rather small beer. It's rather small beer in the Jewish time. I mean, even Philo of Alexandria, the great figure that we know about from whom we know most about Alexandrian Judaism, sends all of his devotion to the Jerusalem temple. And as far as we know, the Jewish population of Alexandria are basically Jerusalem-oriented. The Leontopolis temple is essentially, as you say, a particular priestly family that tries to set up its own franchise, and it doesn't last very long, nor is it very successful. And it's essentially an argument over who is the right priestly family. But in the case of the early Jesus movement, we're talking about a claim that says that the God of Israel is now to be understood as the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. They're identifying themselves and identifying their faith and their status with God with reference to the figure of Jesus. And I really don't think there's anything comparable in the Leontopolis upstart movement.
And before we get too far away from just the theism issue, if I may, it's a double-edged sword. I think Carey's on point to say that from the beginning, the worship of Jesus, elevating him to the status of divine and God, is a smash mouth point between the Jesus movement and historic Judaism. But when you get, and we're still in pre-Constantinian proto-orthodoxy here, when the pagans begin to criticize the Christians, they're criticizing them for the same reason Socrates is being criticized by the Athenians, that ironically, he's an atheist. Or that for the early Christians, they're atheists. And certainly Justin is answering among other charges. Christians are atheists.
Yes.
So the theism issue cuts both ways. They're redefining God within Judaism, and in the eyes of at least some of the Greeks, Roman Greeks, they are eliminating God, and so they're either heretics or they're atheists, and they're like the bug getting it from a brick from both sides.
So as the publisher, can I plug the book for a second? This is, I think, precisely the point of what Larry's trying to do here. It's not only that Christianity's un-Jewish.
Yeah, that's why I wanted to get back to that.
It's un-Roman at the same time. I mean, it has a double distinction of being intolerable to Judaism because of its worship of Jesus, and it's intolerable to Roman society.
And in the second and third century, that's the more overt pressing issue.
Yeah. There really is, as Mark said earlier, Christians become really bad neighbors. I mean, they're not celebrating the 4th of July. They're not participating. They're not going to the pub. They're not. You can go down the laundry list of items that they're doing, and as Larry outlines in the book, and they're bad Romans as well as being bad Jews.
All right. In that regard, let's talk about their behavior. The behavior of Christians at this point in time. I want to do it under a couple of different rubrics. I've got 4 points if we can cover them. First of all, there are the allegations that are made for persecuting Christians. Some allege that they're cannibals because they talk about these secret meals where they're eating flesh and blood of somebody.
They're incestuous.
They're incestuous. Everybody's related. Brother this and sister that.
And they're all kissy facing each other.
Yeah, they kiss each other and they have these love feasts. And it just all sorts of, dogs and cats living together. It's the whole thing's just fallen apart. How Larry helped kick this off. How un-Roman is this? What's going on here?
Well, it is and it isn't. It all depends on who you're talking to. I mean, certainly it seems to me that the the Christians, shall we, when we're using that term, I'm saying it's an anachronistic term, but it trips off the tongue easier than those who are adherents of the Jesus movement, so let's call them Christians for the moment. These early Christians are, and in the main we're talking about particularly pagan Christians, and I use the word pagan not in a pejorative sense, but just simply as the way classicists use it to mean people who were neither Jews nor particularly Christians. So these are pagans, or ex-pagans, depending on the way you want to talk about them. They are members of pagan families, they're members of pagan guilds and associations, and living in pagan cities. They're identified by their family and by their ethnos and so on. And as far as they're concerned, they still are. They're saying, I'm still a Roman or an Athenian or Egyptian or Syrian or whatever. My faith has not made me anything less than that. I am still that. However, the problem is that the gods are involved in every aspect of social life. Every Roman family has household deities set up in which the family are to express their family solidarity by reverencing the household deities. That's how you show that you're a full member of that household, whether slave or free, is you join in acknowledging the deities that guard over the house and keep it. If you're a member of a city, you demonstrate your solidarity and your loyalty to the city by joining in the annual or whatever it is celebration of the tutelary guardian deity of that city. And if you are, you know, a member of a particular ethnos, you have your ethnic gods, Egyptian, Syrian, Roman, Greek, whatever else. So all aspects of life. There is no, in the Roman world, we have to say, there is no secular space. There is no space that is not touched by gods. And so if you wish to be a Christian, you have only two choices. One is to go off into the desert and so on, which the Christians at this period don't do. Or else you have to, what we would say, negotiate your existence 24/7. In every social occasion, in every family event, in every civic event, you have to judge, what are you going to do? How are you going to participate in this group where the gods are up front acknowledged? You can't acknowledge those gods, really, you're not supposed to, really, and yet you want to be, and you are still a member of that society. So the first problem, or the first aspect of your behavior immediately is what I refer to as negotiating your existence. Let me give you an example. I had a PhD student from a few years back who was from Hong Kong, Chinese lady. And I was chatting with her one day and said, are your family Christian? And because many Hong Kong families are. And she said, no, they're a traditional Chinese religion. So I said, well, how does that work with your family? She said, when the family gets together for our occasions, they set up the images of the family deities at the front and people go up and make offerings. And she said, I go to those occasions and I stand at the back of the room. I don't go forward. And she said, it's my way of saying, I'm a member of the family, I'm here, but I can't do what you're doing. Mm-hmm. Now that's just one little minor thing happening right now in present day Hong Kong. One little minor example of the sort of thing that I think pagan Christians whose relatives, extended family, whose professional association or whatever were involved, were colored, marked, identified by pagan deities. Just one of the ways in which Christians would have had to deal with this question. 1 Corinthians chapters 8 and 10 in particular show Paul wrestling with certain examples of how you negotiate your existence as a newly minted pagan Christian living in a pagan city. So that's the first thing, is that they would have had to figure out how to be loyal members of a family, loyal members of a city or of the empire, which identified itself with the gods whom they could not accept.
The silversmith's guild.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, in this regard, the Roman society was very stratified. You had citizens. They had very clear citizen rights that were not shared by others. You had those who owned slaves. You had those who were slaves. The legal structure was very specific in that regard. And there were very defined roles and very defined rights and access to community life and benefits. And then in comes Christianity. And you've got all of a sudden not just a breakdown in wall between Roman or Greek and Jew, but you've got a breakdown in economic walls. Christian, we'll go to you with this. Paul and what he writes to Philemon about Onesimus is in, I would think, the Roman world, at least from a legal perspective, Paul is writing some absolute mind-bending legal changes for the Roman world when he tells Philemon to accept Onesimus, who should be punished by death to keep the Roman legal order as a runaway slave, but he's told not only to accept him back, but to welcome him as if he were Paul himself. Can you visit about that for a minute? And then, Carey, I want you to pick up from there and expand on it about how Christianity becomes the faith of the rich and the poor alike.
Yes, Philemon is one of the shortest texts in the New Testament. I was going to say books, but it's not even a book. I mean, it's anyway a letter, and to call these few, I think it's 300-some words in Greek, a book is just kind of disproportionate. It's more a postcard, if anything. Okay, a short email. But indeed, Paul does at least two very unusual things, and Mark, you've already referred to one of them, that a person in high standing, that being Philemon, who actually runs his own house church, so he probably also had some kind of chapel there and had a, you know, discussion panels at his church, and so he was a person of good standing, but that Paul would then try to broker a relationship with, and then really, I mean, you got to be kidding, with a slave who, you know, counts as a machine, you know, I mean, it's really hard for us today to understand slavery, which is a good thing that we have a hard time understanding that because it's a long time ago, but I mean, really, a slave is not more than maybe a car or a computer, you know, if it gets stolen, what am I talking about, then it's gone, you don't really care about it. If a slave gets sick, you know, it's bad for the slave, but I mean, they might just be disposed of. So a slave doesn't really have a lot of worth. And why would, on earth, Paul, why would previously Jesus care for all these people at the bottom of society? The other thing that is astounding about Philemon, the short little letter, is the way in which it was written, because Paul had a certain standing as an apostle already when that was written, because it was late in his life, it was an imprisonment letter, so Paul is in prison. But Paul doesn't just use his authority and say, you know, kavum, this is what you have to do because, you know, I'm the apostle or super apostle, and you're just kind of a house circle leader, but he really tries to talk to him at a very different level, and just to observe the language of Paul and the argument, how he's doing that, how he talks to him as a, you know, at the same level, that in itself is just really mind-boggling. It shows that Christians, and really that starts with Jesus, had this absolutely astounding appreciation for people who are outsiders, who are ostracized, who are at the bottom, who are poor, who are slaves, who are women, by the way. And if we look at Jesus, he talks to people he isn't supposed to talk to. He accepts to be touched by women, and you're not supposed to be touched by a woman. At this point, images come to mind where Orthodox Jews who have to sit in an airplane next to a woman suddenly start wrapping themselves in plastic. So that's actually not a 2,000-year-old problem. We still have that today. And so Paul picks that up from Jesus himself, Jesus who then also, in Jesus' life, where that all was manifest, in meals that Jesus had, he was typically invited somewhere, but he expected that certain people who typically didn't belong to the upper society were invited there as well, and that they could socialize. And now, okay, if we talk about meals, forget all fast food, okay, that wasn't just about eating. With who you had a meal, that was with to who you belonged. I mean, you really established a long-term bond with those people. So that really established your environment, your social environment, in the Jewish and in the Greco-Roman society. So having meals with people who were not really of your status was something that was certainly at least frowned upon, if not considered really totally countercultural, because much of the societal stratification back then was really established through these kind of societal rituals, and meals were probably the most important among them.
All right, that's very, very good. So Carey, take from that and talk to us about how Christianity becomes the faith of the poor, but also of the rich.
Yeah, well, first of all, what Christian just outlined was wonderfully spoken, and I think that he really captures much of the hues of what's going on in these early churches, that an astounding thing is happening. And we're now tone deaf to this. We're tone deaf to it because we are living in, you know, a late Christian culture or an early post-Christian culture. It's hard to describe. But we've experienced Christianity from the dominant side of things. And it's very hard to rewind into a world where Christianity was not dominant. And that the kinds of practices that Christian outlined were stunning. And you could label this apocalyptic. You could label it millenarian. You could label it. The only kind of modern equivalents would be, you know, when we label groups in our culture that are clearly outside the mainstream of our culture. And because they're doing something that's different than the rest of the culture. And this is early Christianity. And yet, as we've already heard, Christians didn't retreat away. They remained right in the cities doing this. So they were different while being in the middle of it. And yes, it was women, it was the poor. The people who study economics in the first couple of three centuries, there's a lot of theorizing that goes on because we don't have a lot of material evidence about exactly how much money people were making and how to stratify the societies. But the people who look at this stuff and apply kind of high-end metrics to it do say that, you know, Christianity comes from the lower ends of the socioeconomic spectrum, and it's women, it's slaves, it's poor, and this is where it flourishes. And yet, in the middle of these communities are people who have money, and it causes problems. I mean, the Roman Church, Romans is written to address some of that inequity. People who have, in 1 Corinthians 2, people who have enough money to show up early for the feast and have plenty, they stopped by and collected a really nice meal while everybody else had to run by Jack in the Box. And so there's a lot of, you know, tension about what people have and don't have within the church. And it's solved not by any other means than paying attention to Jesus as a mediator of that.
I love your Corinthians example, because this is another area where we have so much trouble, I think, putting ourselves back into first century Christianity. We live post-Constantine. Post-Constantine, Sunday is a day off. We had blue laws until very recently that were enacted way back in the time of Constantine. And it was this idea that Sunday is a day of worship. It's the Lord's day. It's the day of resurrection. But you go back to the first century, Sunday's a work day. Yeah. And so the church is going to gather together for this common meal, and the rich people can get there early because they don't have to work in the way that the slaves do. But the slaves and the poor are the ones that come in late, and the rich people have already had a chance to set up their food, take the best spaces in the peristyle, they can just sit there and enjoy everything. And then the slaves come in later, and that's okay because they're there to clean up anyway, and they can have the dregs of what's left. And Paul really takes them to task over that. So somewhere in the midst of this also, though, is an education issue, because the poor are not going to be educated to the level, typically. And I'll go back to the Philemon example, and we'll transfer over to the bookishness issue, which I'll pull down to this end of the table for discussion. The Jews were very clearly people of books. They had scribes. They had people who wrote. They had scriptures that were not in Old Testament. They were in scrolls, and they were maintained, and they were read by a number of different people every synagogue day, certainly. Now, you've got the Roman world where the slaves really don't know much of anything unless they're slave teachers. There were slave teachers, so we shouldn't act as if they had nothing. But if you take a slave like Onesimus, now, Onesimus is the slave in the postcard. I like that. We call Philemon. Onesimus is, it comes from the Greek word that means useful. It's a slave name. You don't call a slave owner useful. That's the name you give to the slaves. Onesimus runs away. We're dealing probably in Paul's Roman captivity, so somewhere in the 50s. Is that fair to say? So Onesimus runs away in the 50s. I suspect, at least being a 56-year-old man, that he ran away when he had more energy than a 56-year-old man has. If you're going to run away, that's something you'd do as an adolescent when you're full of vim and vigor. So you've got this maybe mid to late teenage boy who runs away, who makes it to Rome, who gets adopted by Paul, for lack of a better way of saying it. Paul sends him back. Onesimus is useful. Onesimus goes back in the 50s, and lo and behold, 50, 60 years later, you've got a gentleman who's on his way to Rome to be martyred, and he's writing letters back to churches. And he writes back to the church at Ephesus, and he says to the church at Ephesus, he writes to the bishop, Onesimus. And he makes nice little puns off of Paul's book of the Philemons. And I know a lot of scholars have questioned, how does a slave name get to be the head of the church in Ephesus, which is the center from which Philemon would have been on the outskirts? But it would have been the center church. And some scholars surmise, I think fairly, that it's very conceivable that this Onesimus was the same one, a collector of Paul's letters, who made sure that his postcard got involved in that collection of, or corpus of, Paul's material. But the church quickly becomes a collector of Paul's letters, one way or another. The church quickly becomes, Paul is not the only writer. The church is producing other writings as well. You've got the gospel narratives, you've got the narrative of Luke, Acts. The church becomes a people of the book. An educated people. We read the reference in Peter to other scriptures and referencing writings of Paul as perhaps scriptures. You know, you've got Paul writing to the Romans, and he says, what's the advantage to being a Jew? And out of all of the illustrations he can pull out, the one he pulls out is they were entrusted with the oracles of God, with the words of God, the scriptures. What is it that was so important and unique about the bookishness of the early church? Rubel and Larry, you two riff on that.
Part of it certainly is content, but I want you to go into what you talked about in terms of scrolls, codex. I think some of that's very interesting, but part of it has to do with the level of instruction where household codes gets transformed by Christian ethic. Mm-hmm. And what people are instructed to do as Christian becomes very distinctive, and it destroys the codes which before, so long as you offered the sacrifice, behavior could pretty well be non-involved. You're religious if you go to that temple and offer that sacrifice. We tend to equate ethical behavior with Christian commitment. That's one of the things that destroyed the gods as these books, this literature, these household codes get transformed into Christian codes, and how those books become authoritative, and even the way they're transported and circulated. Mm-hmm. But develop it as you did a bit in your book, if you would, for us.
Well, as Mark said, we know that from the earliest years, in the Jesus movement, texts are important. The earliest extant Christian texts are the letters of Paul. which take us back to perhaps as early as the late 40s or early 50s. They most certainly are not the earliest texts, but they are the earliest extant texts that we have. Christians seem to have been writing to one another letters and exchanging things and probably putting together collections of Jesus' sayings in written form, probably putting together collections of Jesus' miracles in written form, and so on. So Christians, yeah, are very much a producer of texts. This is one of the points that I try to make in the book, is that the bookishness, that is the centrality of the reading of books, the use of categories of scripture, of sacred writings, and so on, all derive from the Jewish matrix of which they're a part. But what's remarkable is not only that Christians read texts as scripture the way other Jews do, and copy them and so on and share them, but that they start producing on a kind of almost maniacal scale their own writings. From the letters of Paul onward, I did, when I was writing the chapter, one of the things I did was sit down with a kind of standard inventory of early Christian literature, kind of introduction to early Christian literature, which just goes through itemizing and saying what it contains and giving you a bibliography on each text and so on. And by about the middle of the third century, by my count, we know of at least 250 or more Christian writings that had been produced. And keeping in mind that by about the year 200, you know, only God knows for sure, but scholars work with a set of figures that say maybe there were 200,000 Christians by about 200. So we're talking about a small group, even at that point, out of, say, 50 million people in the Roman Empire. And yet they're producing these texts. And it's only, you know, the evidence that we have is all we have, all we can work with. But based on the evidence that we have, I don't think we have anything like the same production of texts going on in the larger Jewish community at the time, even though early Christianity is a small sect or body in comparison. So it's a phenomenal production, plus the investment that they make in the copying and distribution of these texts. They're sending them, they're exchanging them, and making copies of them phenomenally. And now, all that to say, what Mark has just said, is that by all reckoning, the great majority of people in the Roman Empire could not read well enough to read these writings for themselves. But bear in mind two things. One, in a group of illiterates, all you need is one literate person for everybody to experience the writing. And actually, if you know much about illiterates, you will know that they will experience a writing read out much more vividly than a literate person will. Mm-hmm. They may very well commit much of it just by hearing it one time. Much more, they will retain much more of it because they have had to develop those retentive powers and cannot, they are not de-skilled the way literate people are, relying on texts. But the other thing to say is, of course, the illiterate person will regard a text much more emotively than a literate person will. For us, this is a copy of a book that some bloke has written, and it may or may not be worth the reading. But to an illiterate person, this is a bunch of squiggly stuff on a page that you can't quite figure out what it is, but somebody who knows how to do it can sit down and take these squiggles and make them into poetry or powerful prose or philosophical discourse, and it's magic. So we cannot say, because by one reckoning perhaps 90% of people in the Roman world were illiterate, texts were insignificant. In a world like that, texts are king. And the early Christians are massively committed and committing their resources to the writing, copying, distribution, and sharing of texts. And bear in mind, the other thing, there is no postal system. There's no public postal system. So when you want to send a letter, and we know that people were writing letters, by the way, not just Christians, but everybody in the Roman world is writing letters like crazy. We have thousands of Greek letters that derive from the Roman period. And we have letters that say, for example, I've written you faithfully for the past 2 weeks and I've not received a letter yet. What's wrong? And the letter in question is written by a Roman soldier stationed out on the Nabataean border in modern-day Jordan, writing back to his father in Egypt, and he says, I've written faithfully to you for the last 10 days, and I haven't received a letter. Why not? He's expecting to receive a letter. He's 8 days march out onto the Nabataean frontier, and he's expecting to receive a letter from his father within the last fortnight. So, and there's no postal system. So letters are sent phenomenally by people, just using traders and merchants and traveling merchants. The early Christians are either doing that and or sending one of their members, who want, you know, if you want to send a copy of a letter to another church, you to get one of your people in the church and you say, take this letter over to the other place. He has to invest his time, might be a day, 2 days, 3 days, 8 days, whatever, to get to another city. He has to invest his time in that. He has to be fed for that period of time. So either he has to do it himself or the church has to finance it. So as I'm saying, financial resources and time and commitment simply to the translocal distribution of texts. And we know that the early Christians are doing it on a for such a small group, on a phenomenal scale. So that's what I mean by saying they're committed to books and are, in that sense, the word certainly bookish. The other thing to say, is one thing you alluded to, is that also at a very early point, some of these writings begin to be regarded not simply as Christian writings, Christian scriptures, edifying things, but begin to be treated as Holy Scripture. The earliest reference you mentioned is in 2 Peter, where a collection of Paul's writings, it appears, is being treated as Scripture. And, it is interesting, treated as Scripture both by the author of 2 Peter and the blockheads that he's disagreeing with, from his standpoint. Because he refers to those people who take the letters of Paul and twist them. But the interesting thing is, they disagree fervently over how to interpret Paul's letters, but they appear to agree that they are Scripture. So even in this tremendous diversity, you see, and it's a real diversity, because those other guys are blockheads in their interpretation. But it says they twist them as they do the other Scriptures.
Can I add one little small comment here? We take for granted that the documents in the New Testament have titles. Originally, the documents circulated without titles. The reason for a title is because you've got multiplicity. If you've got four Gospels, you've got to have them, you know, the Gospel according to Larry, and the Gospel according to Carey, and the Gospel according to Mark. I mean, you've got to have titles on it. Titles are editorial additions. And titles are betraying the fact that these things are being gathered up, and the titles come early. So Christians, there's a high consciousness of Christian literature among the communities, and the gathering up and the collecting. And it looks like, just from the manuscript evidence with regards to Paul, that there was a group of four, Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, and Galatians, that circulated together. And then there was this other package, if you will, an appendix to Paul, everything else but Ephesians, and then Ephesians was inserted into the Pauline collection as a kind of introduction, both bridging the big four and everything else in the appendix. This is the manuscript evidence looks like there was a high degree of editorial consciousness on the part of the church, you know, within the first two or three centuries, and probably much earlier than that.
Chris.
I wanted to ask a question to Larry, if that's permitted.
It's permitted, but is it on the book issue?
Exactly.
Okay, good, because I've got one more thing on the book issue.
Because, so you say that Christians indeed valued writings, and the New Testament is the evidence thereof. You call it bookish. If indeed for Christians those texts started to become to get the status of scriptures, why were Christians bookish but not codexy? Well, that means that for Jews, typically holy writings had to be rolled up. Sorry for the analogy, but they look more like toilet paper today. It had to be on a scroll, but that was then considered divine. Well, that also meant, for instance, if there was ever a little rip in the page, what would you have to do with this scroll, a Torah scroll? You'd have to bury it, because a Torah scroll is divine, it's perfect, it has to be perfect. By the time there's a little rip in there, they would have to bury them. That's a wonderful thing, because many folks who do textual criticism, archaeologists, find these writings in real cemetery type of things. But Christians were, they actually wrote on pages, on flat pages, as far as I know, and they were bound in books and not in not in scrolls. So actually, the question was maybe more why were they not scrolly? Why didn't they scroll up, write scrolls that were rolled up?
And if I could follow up to that, Larry, as we give it to you to close it up, a lot of secular scholars even will give credit to the Christian church for creating books, at least making them prominent, because not just Jewish scrolls, but so many wrote in scrolls or kept papyrus leaves or whatever they may have kept. But the idea of a codex of a book that's going to accumulate, you know, you go into the Jewish synagogue and you can pull out the Torah scroll that's Bereishit, which is didn't have a title, but they'd take the first word of the Jewish scroll and that would be the title. So in the beginning, Bereishit is Genesis. You'd go pull out that scroll, but all of a sudden the Christian church comes out and starts putting these things together in book form. They found the Carey Newman of the 4th century or the 3rd century, and they've got codexes coming out. And one argument that I've read is that's because Christians were such bookish people that they needed to be able to thumb through to find what they wanted, as opposed to pulling out a different scroll and unrolling it 20 feet. If you've got Acts, that's going to be a 20-foot scroll, maximum length scroll for Luke or Acts. 24 feet, whatever it was. But the Christians wanted to be able to go to the page. They wanted to be able to, what we would say, chapter and verse, though it wasn't set up necessarily that soon, or not at all that soon. Chapters maybe, but not verses. Demarcations. Comment. Close us out with this.
I suppose you could say that the early Christian movement are the codexers. You know, they don't use the word, but they certainly are. They certainly seem to have been distinguished by that. Not simply Jews, but according to the evidence that we have, the extant writings, copies of writings that survive, the roll or the scroll was the king, the dominant book form, especially for literary texts. The codex, the term codex, is a book, a term that we use for an early form of the leaf book. That is a form of writing in which you have sheets of writing material folded and somehow stitched together, and then you turn leaves. The early form of that is we refer to as a codex. The other and dominant writing form is the roll, the literary roll. Codexes were used from at least first century onward, no doubt, if not earlier, but they tended to be used dominantly for everyday tasks or for the sorts of things that you wanted to consult, not read. So books of astronomical tables, books of medical recipes, and other such things. There were also some experiments. Marshall, the Roman witticist, refers to experimentation with small, miniature codexes that were used for portability. And so he says, down at the local bookseller, such and such, you can obtain a small portable copy of my poetry, which make an excellent purchase to take along with you on your travels. And so there were experiments with the codex, but they seem to have been very limited and short-lived and never really took off. From the earliest evidence that we have, and some of our Christian manuscripts are paleographically dated to as early as sometime in the late 2nd century, and perhaps even in a couple of cases maybe a bit earlier, but certainly by about 150 to 200, we think we have at least a small remnants of at least a small handful of Christian manuscripts. And everything that we have from the earliest onward is in codex form for copies of scripture. We actually had, Christians did use the roll for literary texts, but the examples that we have are basically for things like Irenaeus's Against Heresies. Our earliest copies of that in manuscript form is a book roll. The Gospel of Mary, earliest text that we have of that, is a book roll. Two of the three copies of the Gospel of Thomas from the 3rd century are literary book rolls, and so on. So they did use book rolls, interestingly enough, much more freely for texts that they did not treat as scripture. But the writings that they treated as scripture, they seem overwhelmingly, 95, 97% of all of the copies of either what we call Old Testament writings or New Testament writings are in codex form. And so there are two schools of thought, and you've alluded to one. Why did the Christians adopt the codex? There are two basic schools of thought. One school of thought says there were some obvious practical advantage of the codex that led Christians to use it. Ease of consultation, supposedly, or other things. The other school of thought says, no, the reason that Christians preferred the codex so overwhelmingly was they wanted to make a statement. They wanted to mark off their copies, particularly their copies of Christian texts, from non-Christian copies. That is, it had what we call a semiotic purpose, a symbolic purpose. I tend to align myself with the latter group. One of the reasons being, if the codex was so obviously superior for certain purposes, that means that among the entire population of the Roman world, the Christians, bless their hearts, were the only ones intelligent enough to recognize the obvious superiority of the codex. Now, I love my Christian forebears, I have great respect for them, and some of them were kind of intelligent. But somehow that seems very counterintuitive, that alone of the Roman population, the Christians were the only ones to seize upon the obvious superiority of the codex. Beware of such a thought, because it seems obvious superior because we're familiar with it. It's what's comfortable to us, and we think a book roll is awkward. Obviously, if a book roll was all that awkward, people would have thought, this is awkward, let's go with something else. But they didn't. And so people who are comfortable with using book rolls in the ancient world obviously didn't see a problem with finding their place or with handling it or transporting it by and large or whatever. So for what it's worth, I tend to align myself with people like Colin Roberts and others who argued that the appropriation of the codex so enthusiastically in early Christianity was quite deliberate and was intended to say, we know that the book roll is king in the literary world, we're going to do something different. And I think that the other thing to say is that the earliest scraps that we have of book rolls suggest that the codex was not used originally or appropriated originally for multiple texts. The earliest codexes that we have are codex copies of individual texts. Yeah. So a copy of the Gospel of John in a simple codex form. A separate copy of the Gospel of Matthew in a codex form. So far as we can tell, our earliest instances, extant instances of a combination of texts into one codex are probably from around 200 or so. Now, those are the earliest extant copies, so they're unlikely to be the original copies. It may have begun a bit earlier, but it does look as though Christians appropriated the codex initially, even for copies of individual texts, and that the Gospels originally circulated independently. And then by sometime in the late, toward the end of the second century, people began putting our known four Gospels together into one codex or a collection of Paul's letters into one codex. The earliest instances that we have, by the way, are in the splendid Chester Beatty collection that you have in Dublin. So it's a good reason to go to a lovely green Emerald Isle and do stop in at the Chester Library and see their fabulous collection of biblical papyri, which are our earliest instances of a four Gospel codex and our earliest instance of a codex containing the letters of Paul, both of which 200 to 250 AD.
So in that regard, and we do need to bring this to a close, we're basically out of time, but we've got another minute or two. I think about the passage in 2 Timothy where Paul says for Timothy to bring his books, his Biblia, and the parchments, the membranos or whatever.
Especially,
I think he says, the membranai, the parchments. What were those books?
Well, the term...
Biblia.
The Biblia are probably sacred writings, Jewish writings, probably copies of scripture writings, I would assume, or other such writings. The term membrana, you know, Biblia and membranae. The membranae is a Latin term. It's interesting, it's a Latin loan word used in this Greek text.
Right.
And the term membrana, as you indicate, means, you know, membrane. That's what we get our word membrane from. It means a skin. And so it was a term used for a leather roll originally, but also used for leather codexes. And it looks as though its appropriation as a Latin loanword into Greek, think of people such as Theodore Skeet and Colin Roberts and others who argued that it probably is functioning as a technical term for an early form for the codex or leaf book. And so As you may know, there's an argument over who wrote Timothy. If Paul wrote it, then it's an instance that already he is aware of certain writings being put in codex form. If it's written in Paul's name later, as many people think, sort of in the late first century, then it means that even already at that point, Paul, interestingly, if it's somebody writing in the name of Paul, they think of Paul being associated with Biblia, with scriptural texts, and with these membrani, these codex writings, which are probably Christian texts.
Incredibly early, eh? Either way.
Either way, probably first century, yeah.
Okay, would you all join me in thanking him? And...